from Matthew chapter 2, the first 12 verses. Jesus was born at Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of Herod. And after his birth, astrologers from the east arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is the newborn king of the Jews? We observed the rising of his star. We've come to pay him homage." King Herod was greatly perturbed when he heard this. So was the whole of Jerusalem. He called together the chief priests and scribes of the Jews and asked where the Messiah was to be born. "At Bethlehem in Judea," they replied. "This is what the prophet wrote: Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, you are by no means least among rulers of Judah, for out of you shall come a ruler to be shepherd of my people, Israel." Then Herod summoned the astrologers to meet them secretly and ascertain from them the exact time when the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, said, "Go, make a careful search for the child, and when you've found him, bring me word, so that I may go myself and pay homage." After hearing what the king had to say, they set out. There, before them was the star they had seen rising, and it went ahead of them until it stopped above the place where the child lay. They were overjoyed at the sight of it, entered the house. They saw the child with Mary, his mother, and bowed low and worshiped. They opened their treasure chests and presented gifts to him: gold, frankincense, myrrh. Then they returned to their own country by another route, for they had been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod. The Christmas story as it closes. Drew, blessings on you. Spread the word.
Wise men still seek him, and it happens today, not just back then. I want to begin by saying that this sermon is in my heart, whether I deliver or not, it's another matter, is for the outsider. Today's sermon is really for the visitor. Today's sermon is for those of you who might be seeking and don't even really know why you're here. That circumstances have brought you here, and they're maybe even bigger than you even understand. And that's the nature of God. And may God bless you in that seeking. So I've got some stuff I need to talk about today, and it begins with what Guy just read to you, is the story of the Magi, the three wise men. The text doesn't actually say there were three wise men. We say there's gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Therefore, we kind of, tradition says three wise men. There really actually could have been 50, could have been 100 of them. Don't know. Okay? Imagine that arriving in Bethlehem. And at Christmas, when you come to church services on December 24th, 25th, and you come, and we always have the angels and the baby Jesus in the manger and the donkeys and everything. And often you see the wise men also there at the manger scene. Please nod. Are you with me on that? Okay. That's actually bad biblical work, right? But we pull the story all together because it was, the wise men don't arrive till today. That's why there's 12 days of Christmas. My true love gave to me, right? You sing all 12 days. There's 12 days of Christmas. So, Guy, you're right. Your Christmas tree should not be out of the house until today. Where I want you to know is not just to the outsider. In the reading of this text today, for today, now, you imagine, I'm a church guy, I'm your pastor here. I've read the text before, you know, like I kind of know the story. And yet, something new came to me in my reading and reflection. And it's really wonderful to be a Christian for a long time and new stuff still. Now, maybe I'm slower than most, and I get that. But something happened, and I went, wow, that's really interesting. And I hope before the sermon's out, I'll be able to share with you what that peace is. See, because in church land, today I could have put a sign up here that had the three wise men, and I would have written Epiphany Sunday. Now, if you were raised in the church and you were raised with your Bible, and you'd kind of know, yeah, it's Epiphany, I get that, right? But if you're an outsider and you've never been in the church and you come and they're talking about it's Epiphany Sunday, I heard one person say, is that like a disease or something? I don't, what have you got? Like, I don't know what the word means. Well, it does simply mean manifestation. That God manifests himself in ways more than you can ask or imagine. And that's part of what this story's about, is that he is seeking even the magi. And that ties in to what I've been preaching about. And I started a little series last week. And it was called, it's about faith development and the stages of faith. And today is kind of part two. So if you missed part one, I'm sorry. You can get it online. We tape the sermons and up they come and there they be. But I'd like to just put up stage. It's called stage theory, and there's many different stages of faith. Because I don't know where you are. You might be a very mature Christian. You might be a total outsider who's still seeking, and you don't know where you are. And today's text actually lands quite well into this. So last week, and I will just briefly cover, was stage one and two. So stage one is chaotic antisocial. These are people who, and it is an actual stage. There is a faith. Okay? It's just chaotic. It's not a non-believer. Stage one is actually beyond a non-believer. It is a person who's gone to a place of, yeah, I guess, but I got all sorts of people say, well, I believe in God. And I go, great, but so do a lot of people. So the question is, what is the nature of the God? Where is your faith? Where are you in this food chain? And arguably one in five people are living there. And even maybe more if we're looking outside the church, but that it's more complicated than what I'm communicating this morning. But they can be antisocial, they can be narcissists, they can be leaders of your church. Oh gosh, there you are. Don't look in the mirror, there we are, okay. So I'm hoping I'm further along, but I touched on that to some degree. And then people move through a matter of crises to stage two. Our churches are full of people in stage two. It's what we call the formal structure, the formal institutional. It is something that anchors people. And the reason people love stage two is because stage two makes you know what's north and what's south. When I was a non-believer, yeah, I converted. I spent a lot of time on the outside of the church. And then I came into the church. And when I came into the church, one of the things I was really thankful for was stage two. I was thankful for the formal and the structural. And that's when you go to, certainly to an Anglican church, and we use our Book of Common Prayer, right? And we you know, the prayer is on page 365, and so you turn in, you read the prayer. It's very structured, it's very formal, it's very safe. Hear me now. Christianity is not safe. Faith is not safe. It's true. There is no other life. But trust me, God may take you on a journey like a wise man and take you places you never thought you would go, right? It's like the guy who goes, and the people in stage two is, a guy goes to a church in England, and it's an Anglican church, and there's 30 people there, and he's a Pentecostal, and he comes into church, and he's kind of looking around, he's kind of suspicious, and the preacher gets going, and the preacher's on the money, and the guy goes, amen. Well, the Anglicans are all looking around going, okay, what was that? And somebody just said amen in the middle of the service. That was inappropriate. And But he looks at no one says, and he keeps preaching. And then the guy in the back, he's like, man, I didn't believe an Anglican preacher could actually. Amen to that, brother. Well, you know, everybody's Anglican. They're very polite. So what they do, they're looking around for a warden. If you're a warden, put up your hand. These two over here, okay? And there's a warden over here. And so what they do is they say, after the church service, they come up to the guy. And they one of the parishioners go to the warden and says, you got to talk to this guy. So they walk over and says, excuse me, sir. We don't praise the Lord here in this church. We do that on page 284. Okay? That's stage two. That's formal. That's got structure to it. But I'll tell you, we live in a crazy world. Stage two isn't all bad. Stage two is actually kind of nice because it tells me that there's some sanity, there's some structure. And the ancient church gave us liturgy. Liturgy being, you know, this structure, and then you do an opening prayer and then a creed and a Eucharist, and everything is very formal. And the reason they gave, one of the reasons they gave stage two and formalism was to prevent vainglory, to prevent pride, prevent the people who are leading the service from getting out of hand. So we need structure for the safety of the people, because you never know what them clergy are going to get up to. What's going on? Well, then we move to stage three. And this is where I kind of want to go today, is that stage three and four. Now, I've had a full week. If you've been away, we've had a full week here in the life of the parish. We've had a couple funerals and people who are deeply loved. I must have had 400 or 500 people in the door here in the last 36 hours. That's how busy this place has been, right? So when I come into a pulpit, I normally have a page or two of notes. Today I have 9 pages of notes, and that's something you need to be worried about, okay? Because that means we could really go on. A good sermon, I get this reduced to 1 or 2 pages, maybe 3, right? So pray, okay? No, what I'm going to do is use the forum today to unpack. If you have further questions, you want to go deeper, and I haven't explained something in the depth it needs, then that's the place to go. But I have enough to guide us through here. Skeptical individual is stage three. This is actually a very healthy place. That all of a sudden, you're moving beyond the boundaries. And in fact, creeds and canon laws and rules that the church in its institutional form are starting to not work for you. Or you really are questioning. The healthiest, and there's emphasizing the word healthiest of teenagers, because not all teenagers are healthy, right? We got that. It's a growth place. But the healthiest place, a lot of teenagers who come into church are intuiting and going, I need more. This isn't, there's too much structure here. It's too formal. It's not meeting me. Stage three. And it comes across as skeptical. They're questioning. So if you have a 20-year-old in your home who's asking a lot of questions and really pushing your buttons, that's a healthy, normal, good place. In fact, you're not going to get to a mature faith unless, in fact, you get through skeptical. So here's the lesson to the traditionalists. Tell me you've moved beyond stage two. Because in stage two, it's very safe. And stage two people are offended often by stage three people. Stage three people can make life for a stage twoer at church really unpleasant. How come the children are running around? That's not right. It's supposed to be quiet and formal here. What do you mean there's kids in chaos? Kids in chaos is a beautiful thing. Not if you're living in stage two. So this is a healthy, normal stage. May I suggest to you that the wise men, my guess, I'm speculating, work with me, are stage three. that in fact they are truly seeking and they are going places that we wouldn't necessarily go. And it's a good thing. Let me just touch on stage four and then just get back to the stage three, because I think we live in a culture of all these stages. There's a lot of chaotic antisocial, but I think that there is a lot of healthy stage three out in the world. Stage four is where I hope you get to. Stage four is this mystical communal place where you start to recognize everything comes together. And you are now not threatened by ambiguities. You actually enjoy ambiguity. You enter into mystery with a certain calm, as opposed to, I need it all worked out. And until I get it worked out, I will not be a believer. How many of you bumped into a person like that, right? Tell me first and then I'll believe, okay? There, that could be either stage one or three. And it's hard to discern it. So it's not an easy little package here. And I can preach stage four, but be internally in a stage two place. It's way easier to preach what I do. It's way easier to preach about what I'm talking about than it is to live it. Trust me, just talk to my wife. She knows, okay? I mean, it's not always easy. So the stage four is this mystical communal where things start to come together. And when in fact, there's a lot of people at stage four who come back and start to love the institutional and the structure and the formal and the liturgy, believe it or not. What there's all of a sudden there, and from an outsider's look, a stage four looks like a stage two. You can't tell the difference. They're both happy. Okay? I stand up. Let's all stand up and say the creed. What? Says a stage threer? What do you mean stand up and say the creed? But to a stage four person, saying the creed is actually a joy. It's right there on the wall. I believe in God, the Father of my wife. What is it you believe? This is what I believe. And you're internalizing. It's this deep, mystical place. And there's so much more to say about stage four, but that's when we come to this holy table. And in one sense, it's bread and wine. But in the mystery, in the sacrament of it all, there is this real presence, and it's mysterious. But we believe in faith that God is mysteriously present when we come and break bread together. Jesus, at the Last Supper, he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, do this in remembrance of me. So that's kind of where we live and move and do what we do. Here is part of the concern is that this is part of the crisis of the mainline church. Touched on this at 9 o'clock. And it's important to be repeated. Part of the problem with mainline church is that we banked on the fact that the growth of the church would happen generationally. That my children would become Christians and their children would become Christians and would just come along and the pews would continue to be full. It's not 1952. And here's the piece. Christianity is always one stage away from extinction. I am born Canadian. I can't un-Canadian myself. That's the way it is. I'm born into it. Christianity is not that way. Everybody has to do their work. Each of you has to be a wise man. Each of you has to do your own individual searching before you move to the communal. Because otherwise, if you're in the communal and you haven't done your individual work, what happens is chaos in the midst. And that's why church is often difficult. Because you might be worshiping next to a person at stage one. And then you go, I don't want to be in this church because there's all these people that drive me crazy. And God says, get to stage four and you'll love them. And there's this mystical coming together where we need one another. See? So here's the piece that I find interesting. And by the way, next Saturday morning, I take this really seriously. Is a new member ministry. There are people who are new to this congregation in the last year. And why don't you come on the Saturday? I'll get you out, as I said, before noon, 9:30 to noon. Why don't you come and ask your questions and let me walk you through these things. So come to St. John's and we'll see if we can work through some of your questions. But here's the piece about the Magi. We call them three kings, but be clear, they are magic men. It's where we get the root word of magic, the Magi. They are Persian. Now, if you don't know the story, that means they're Iranian. They are not from a Christian Jewish, that's the point. They're not from a Jewish Judean culture. And they're following a star. Here's the piece that was new to me. Matthew's gospel, now this is for the insiders, and if you're growing and new and whatever, but Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, four gospels. Matthew is arguably the most Jewish of all the texts. It's the teacher's gospel. Matthew is writing to Jews who've converted to Christianity. We're waiting for the Messiah. You're a Jew, you're waiting for the Messiah. You're a Persian, you don't even know what a Messiah is. Hasn't even crossed your mind. To a Jew, to a Matthew reader, let's pore over the scriptures and see prophetic texts that come out of here that tell us that the Messiah will come. Magi do not have a holy text. And yet, they are the first to bring homage to Jesus. Isn't that staggering, really? That the first people who come and worship Jesus are stage three people who've never gone through stage one and two, arguably. They haven't done churchianity, as it were. They're outsiders who teach the insiders what is real. Are you a visitor? Are you a magi? Are you a person? See, here's the thing. It's actually offensive. They're looking at the stars. They're astrologers. How many of you read your zodiac for the year? Come on, tell the truth. How many of you? A couple of hands have gone up, right? What is that? Like Arthur C. Clarke, the great science fiction writer, he says, I don't believe in astrology. I'm Sagittarius and I'm a skeptic. Okay? The Jew who is reading this text, who hears Matthew say these magi are looking at the stars, they're going, Deuteronomy 28, 1 to 2, tells me that it is forbidden to wear tattoos, to look at the stars, to have your palm read. They're going, what do you mean guys are looking at stars? My point is that you can come to God anyway. Two words there, any way. You might have been at a movie and something was said in that movie that just so struck you and you went, yeah, there really is a God. I got to do some work here. I got to find out more about this. And you know nothing about this beautiful text. You know nothing about our traditions, and that's okay. And that's one of the reasons we don't always push tradition on the newcomer, but yet the tradition meets us as we move into the faith, and this is the difficulty of being church. At what point are we meeting the stage threer, and at what point are we meeting the stage fourer? And it's really hard to do worship on a Sunday when you've got all these different needs. The new idea to me was, as I've already expressed it, is that Matthew, who's so Jewish, would in fact choose an outsider to reveal the truth of who this Jesus is. And they're not looking for a Messiah, they're looking for a king. Are you looking for someone who's a king? I know that in my spiritual life, in my 20s, I got to the point where I said, there is too much chaos out there. And I was 20 a few years ago. Okay? And there was too much chaos out there. And I said, tell me there's a star to follow. And I didn't understand Messiah. I didn't understand resurrection. I didn't understand atonement. I didn't understand anything. All I knew was that this Jesus was worth following. King of kings, Lord of lords. And he will transform your life. And that's the gift. Here's my last piece for today, because we're going to move to communion. And there's so much more to say about stages of faith. It's good for you to know what stage you're in. Especially, and for you to know other people, if you understand this, then you will become a better evangelist. You will be better at not being threatened by your questions, being able to meet their needs. And you go, okay, this person is at stage two, because it's generally a crisis that moves us through a stage. All right? Midlife crisis, or is it a midlife transition? What's it going to be? Hopefully it's a transition. Here's the piece. These stage three people are naive. They ask, I mean, talk about naive. This is beautiful. This is beautiful. The wise men go to King Herod. Like, what a bad move. I'm going to go to King Herod. He said, we understand that there's a new king who's just been born. And King Herod goes, don't like the sound of that. Why don't you go find him and report back to me, right? What does this story tell you? By the end of chapter 2 in Matthew's gospel, King Herod has had every 2-year-old male killed throughout the whole nation. This gospel stuff is serious business. This Jesus is not safe. And I think that's beautiful that the wise men, then they get a dream. And in that they discern, don't go back to Herod, and they go back home by another way. And we just read that line, and it just kind of flows in and out, but we don't, how does that apply to us? Where are you? But here's the last piece for you is stage 4. You are the mature one in the faith. Are you burdened for the person in stage 3? Or stage 1 or 2? Are you in a place where you're able to nurture a person along in the faith and care for them, cradle them, nurture them, love them? And they might be coming from not our tradition at all. They might be coming from who knows where with their questions. And in your maturity, we are called, they need you. They come and they ask questions. And so I leave you with that. Where are you in your journey? And where are you in the task of bringing others along? For he is Lord of lords. He is King of kings. And we deserve and owe him to fall on our knees and worship him. Amen. Thank you. God bless you.